So today, we're going to try and talk about advanced negotiation techniques. Harvard Law School has this huge department that's dedicated to negotiation strategy. It's one of the best in the world, if not the best in the world. And two of the principals there, two of the original principals, Roger Fisher and William Urey, wrote the book Getting to Yes. Anybody read that? It's one of the best-selling books out there, and it's a lot of the strategy from CCIM's negotiation course and from negotiation in general around the world is based on this theory. We'll talk a little bit about that today. They also came up with the idea of what we call BATNA, which is the way to find the best alternative when you're negotiating if you can't sell something. Now, I'm also going to get into something called Never Split the Difference. Has anybody read that? A number of you. It's a great book. It actually is probably counter in a lot of ways to Getting to Yes, but it talks about the idea of trying to look at things a little negatively. Now, in this particular book, Chris Voss, who's fantastic to listen to, if you ever get to see to listen to any of the Black Swan stuff, he was the head FBI negotiator internationally for kidnappings. And his stories are fascinating, but you can apply all of his kidnapping negotiation strategy back to anything, including real estate. The other two books I have up here, if you haven't read them, and probably 80-year-old book now, How to Win Friends and Influence People by Dale Carnegie, is still relevant today, because we're always looking at human nature and how we can react to each other with human nature. And The 7 Habits of Highly Effective People by Steve Covey, I'm going to rely on a little bit today. Today what we're going to go through is some traditional negotiation and explain what we do and why it doesn't work quite as well as we'd like. We're going to go into a little bit of game theory. We're going to talk about BATNA, interest-based negotiation, how to use negative questions and silence to get the other side to think in your direction if possible, and how to counter tactics like good cop, bad cop, the snow job, squeeze play, the nibble, and some other. And then at the end, we'll talk about some ways to sharpen your negotiating skills. But I want to start out by showing you a really quick video clip. How many of you watch Yellowstone? Everybody watches Yellowstone. All right, this is Beth.
I didn't come here and do business with these people. I came here and do business with you.
I can hear you screaming halfway down the hall, Craig.
Thought we were going to try and work this out, Bob.
We've been trying to work this out for 3 hours, Craig. This is the alternative.
We don't want to merge.
No one wants to merge with you. You have a 3-to-1 debt ratio. It'd be easier to sell VCRs.
I'm not going to be bullied by your hatchet man, Bob. We will pull our funds and we will take our business down the street to Chase.
We're just asking you to suspend the dividend.
And kill the stock.
What do you think's gonna happen when I dump our 18% share tomorrow morning? I'll tell you what, the stock will drop below 10, SEC will suspend trading, and every creditor you have will file on you. Your company will be Chapter 11 by Friday. And since we're your largest creditors, I can promise you there'll be no negotiating then. I will be CEO of IL Energy by Monday. I will fire every f***ing employee. Then I will sell your leases and equipment to Chevron for 30 cents on the dollar. And you, buddy, you will have the unique distinction of being the only drilling company to go bankrupt in the largest oil boom of the last century. Won't that look good on a resume?
I started this company in my garage.
That's where it's going to end up if you don't suspend the dividend and allow us to assume management. Don't look at him. You're dealing with me now. So what's it going to be? Are we restructuring your company tomorrow or killing it?
Good. Made the right choice, Craig. We'll get you through this.
I just saved your house. I put your kids through college. Maybe you should say something more appropriate.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
That's what most of us think of negotiation, right? Very hard negotiating. She did do, incidentally, what was in the best interest of the other party. She just did it in a very difficult way. What's the biggest challenge we have when negotiating real estate? Anybody have an answer for that? What's the biggest challenge you run into? Emotion. Exactly. Emotion is the problem we run into. We deal with things emotionally. Everything we do in life, we deal with emotionally, right? We are emotional and irrational, but we're emotional and irrational in predictable ways. So when we're trying to negotiate with anyone, we have to be able to tap into those predictable ways and figure out how we're going to deal with them. That was written by Chris Voss. What do you really think negotiation is? That's a good way of putting it, trying to come up with a win-win. Anybody else? Trying to get the upper hand is what I was actually thinking. Persuading others to do what you want them to do, to get what we want. That's what most of us think of as negotiation. Doesn't necessarily do what's best for all parties. Have you ever dealt with a difficult negotiator? So who do you find is most frustrating to negotiate with? Let me try and put a couple of them down. Who is most difficult to negotiate with from your life? A moving target, that's good. Win at all cost, that's true. But what people, what groups? That's what I was looking for, your five-year-old daughter. Now, when you're fighting with your five-year-old daughter, what are you fighting over? Bedtime? Toys? What other groups are you trying to argue with on a regular basis you're trying to negotiate with? Owners that overvalue your property, overpriced sellers. Really tough. That's a negotiation, isn't it? Sometimes commission as well. There's lots of different groups that we negotiate with on a regular basis. Some of the ones I put down are buyers and sellers, of course. Investors can be very frustrating. Attorneys. Other brokers, your spouse, your children, and anybody else who drives you crazy. There are negotiations to keep us up at night, too. So some of them that I put down are commission rates with clients. They want us all to list at 2.5%, right? How about unrealistic clients? Rent abatement or stubborn landlords. Zoning approvals are a challenge. Commission splits, commission structures. I love it. Realtors come in. Hey, somebody just offered me a 95% split. And they're giving me a free car. Can you match that? Commission splits. Dealing with contractors, lawsuits, getting kids to do their homework is tough. That keeps us up at night sometimes. And we've got to negotiate with our agents for them to call people back more than once and to get them to actually use MoxieWorks or subscribe to a program like Todd Coleman's. Something that's really going to benefit them. And you've heard all the people in this room talk about how wonderful that program is and how many deals they get. But somebody will say, oh, it's $300. I don't want to spend that per year. Negotiation that we have to do. Traditionally, what we look at is so many times when I'm talking, people want to hire somebody who's got a winning strategy, who's going to use strong tactics, get what they want, not give away the bottom line, use what we call the bag of cement clothes. Anybody heard the bag of cement clothes? I think Tom Hopkins is the first one who talked about that. You're at a listing appointment, and you're with this might be residential, but you're on a listing appointment, you're with the sellers, and you give them the price, and they say, okay, I guess I'll list it, but I can't do it right now because my spouse and I have agreed that we always sit and talk about it at night, and then we sleep on it, and then we'll list it in the morning. And Tom Hopkins would say, that's fine. I'll be right here on the sofa in the morning. Just stop by. That's called the bag of cement clothes. Determining what the other party's pain points are and applying pressure and using time as a negotiating strategy. That's what we think of as good negotiators. What I think is probably a little better interest-based negotiations is the ability to listen. Being well prepared for negotiations, being flexible, having a sense of fairness, and really asking a lot of relevant questions because that's going to get you a lot further in a negotiation. And we're negotiating all the time every day. We negotiate with our children, we negotiate with our spouse, we negotiate with our listings when we go on a listing appointment, we negotiate sales, everything we do is a negotiation. But most of what we do is a traditional method. It's called positional negotiation. Positional negotiation is bargaining. You take a position and you stick to that position. Now let me give you an example. I only have 3 hours free. And what I'd like to do is I'd like to go see John Wick 37. I mean, there's lots of bloodshed. There are more people killed in the last John Wick movie than any war movie that's out there. Just fantastic, he shoots everybody. My wife, on the other hand, she wants to go to the craft show. We've only got 3 hours, man. So guys, can you feel my pain here? And ladies, can you feel my wife's pain? So we've only got so much time. How do we negotiate this kind of dilemma, this transaction? And the problem is that we all think of any negotiation as a pie, and there's only so much we can split. And that might be time and it might be money. We've only got so much free time, we've only got so much money, and we probably can't make it to John Wick and to the craft show at the same time. Another example is we've got a seller that paid $500,000 for a building. We've all heard this one before. I need to sell it for at least $500,000 because I paid $500,000 for it. And the buyer, which is probably the best buyer you're ever going to see, is saying the cap rate in this building right now is 8%. And on the current income, based on that cap rate, it's not worth more than $450,000, and I can't pay more than that because it isn't worth more than that. And we're at an impasse because we can't get past our position. We can't get past that struggle. True or false, people make decisions based on their own interests. Absolutely true. That's what people think all the time. We base everything on our self-interest, and the key to a successful negotiation is sometimes finding a creative way to satisfy everybody's needs in the transaction. We start with a first offer in a typical transaction. Whoever makes the first offer subconsciously sets the expectations of the other parties. It becomes the base from which everything else follows. That first offer is called an anchor. It starts negotiations. And sometimes people come in and they anchor real high or they anchor real low, and we get pulled in the direction of the anchor. Each side takes that position, they argue their position. The more they clarify their position, the more they decide themselves that they're right. They get tunnel vision, they get stuck. Their egos become their position or synonymous with their position. They stubbornly stick to it. They might make some small concessions, but not a lot. They might even lie about what they'll offer in order to consider getting their way. And far too often, it doesn't produce amicable results. So this is what a typical negotiation looks like. On the far right-hand side, or your far right-hand side, is what the seller wants. In the middle is what the seller's reservation price is, what they'll accept as a bottom line. On the left-hand side is the buyer's price, what they want to offer. And somewhere at the middle is where their reservation price is, the most they'll pay. And hopefully, we're going to find a place in the middle where we're actually going to be able to make this work. That's traditionally how we do negotiation. So the first party makes a first offer and subconsciously sets the expectations of the other party involved in negotiation. And if somebody asks a question, if somebody sets a ridiculously high number or a ridiculously low number, one of the things you can always do is go back with, well, Mr. Seller, that's an interesting price or an interesting position. Can you tell me how you arrived at that price? Now, everything we're going to talk about is how to not get into an argument and how to get them answering the right way. So you're going to make your counteroffer based on your ideal outcome and the other party's alternative, and you're going to hopefully lighten the mood with some humor referencing their initial offer. Who should make the first offer on listing price? If you're trying to list a property, do you tell them or should you try and get the seller to tell you what they want? The seller. What about in a commission rate? Do you think it's better for them to tell you what they want to pay or for you to tell them what it is? Yeah, so it can come either way, either side. The opening offer can be problematic because we unconsciously adjust our number to that anchor. If somebody comes up with a crazy number, unfortunately, sometimes we move toward that crazy number. So I'll go into a listing appointment and I think it's worth $500,000 before I get there. And the owner says to me, well, I want $1 million. And I know the one down the street, which I don't have on a comp list anywhere, sold for $1.2 million, and it's honestly not as nice as mine, so that $1 million is a great deal. And then subconsciously, we start moving toward that anchor, toward that number. So even though we didn't want to list it over $550, suddenly we're at $650 or $750 as a list price, and we get ourselves into trouble because we unconsciously move toward the anchor. The other factors that impact our bottom line, pressure. If one side has more pressure than the other, which side is under pressure and how will that sense of pressure or urgency affect the negotiation? And time. But the negotiator uses all the time, unfortunately, sometimes wins, right? Most negotiations we deal with are either hard or soft. Hard negotiators hold out longer, becomes a contest of wills. They focus on haggling and positions and harms the other side. Some of us aren't hard negotiators. So some negotiators would rather get along with people and avoid conflict. They really want more money for the building, but they also want to maintain or build that friendship, that relationship. And they want an amicable solution, but they end up feeling bitter or taken advantage of by the end of the negotiation. And unfortunately, with traditional negotiation, that's often what happens. One or both sides is not real happy. They're disappointed, they're tired, they're worn out, they're frustrated. That's something we're dealing with constantly. I want to shift for a second over to game theory. So we're trying to predict behavior of the clients we're dealing with. We predict our outcomes based on predicting their behavior. And I'm going to spend a lot of time talking about psychology and how to use it later on. Game theory has a lot of different parts to it. One of the ones I'm going to focus in on is zero-sum game. In a zero-sum game theory, one party wins and the other party loses the equal amount, right? Everybody's heard of that? It's called distributive negotiation. We're actually breaking it up into certain components, and each side gets a certain amount, and that's all there is. It's not a win-win situation because there's only so much to go around. The other two game theories that we deal with, one is prisoner's dilemma. So here's what happens. Two realtors are doing so poorly that they go rob a dollar store. Now, what a mistake. They get a stack of dollar bills. They should have robbed something that had money, maybe a Tiffany's or something, but no, they went to a dollar store. They didn't think they'd be caught, but they are caught. And what happens is these two real estate agents get put into two different interrogation rooms, right? One is on one side, one's on the other, and the police are playing them against each other. And the police are saying, if you confess right now, I'm going to give you only 1 year in prison, and the other guy's going to get 8 years. And what usually ends up happening in this scenario is both of them confess, they both end up getting 5 years in jail. Instead, had neither one of them confessed, they'd probably still get nailed, but they each have 2 years in prison. The problem is knowledge. They don't know what's going to happen. People do what's in their own self-interest, so they confess to it, thinking that they're going to get a reduced sentence and it doesn't work. Knowledge and information is power, and mutual cooperation can be beneficial for all parties involved. Now, I'm not saying you should use this to get out of jail. But we have to strike a balance between cooperation and competition. The other one, of course, is what we've been talking about right now, which is a high-low game. Party one opens with a negotiation. They have an offer, an anchor. We focus on that anchor, and then we do a counteroffer, and each party negotiates as if it is a battle of wills. Often neither party is satisfied with the results. And the focus is on positions, on price, rather than anything else. So, hey, Teresa.
Hey there.
I've got a great deal for you. You probably know a hotel that I own down by the dog track. It's worth at least $12 million, but I don't want to put it on the open market, so I'm going to sell it today to you for only $10 million.
Loren, I know that hotel. It sits behind a bunch of other buildings, and it can't even be seen from the road. The traffic counts there are awful. Yeah, it's not worth anywhere near. I'll pay $5
million. You've got to be kidding me. This is a great hotel. That area's growing. Listen, I'll come down to $9 million.
still not interested. The parking is atrocious. There's not a lot of industry around to feed that hotel. I'll go 5.5, but I really can't go any higher.
I can't believe this. Listen, I'm giving you my best all-time price. I never thought I'd go this low. $8 million, that's only because of our past relationship. And incidentally, there is history to that hotel. President Truman actually slept in that hotel.
And the wallpaper and carpet haven't been changed since Truman was there.
You know, they are building a giant Margaritaville resort right around the corner. The investment going into that's going to be $600 million. Into this new Margaritaville, you'd be sitting on a gold mine once the construction is complete. I'm offering it to you for $8 million.
Oh my gosh, Loren. When Margaritaville Resort opens, why would anyone stay at your roadside flea circus with no elevators? I'll go to $6 million, but not a penny more.
I think we're at an impasse. I think you've hurt my feelings and I'm upset, so I think we were at an impasse. And that's how most negotiations go, right? And then eventually we try and come around and hopefully we end up meeting somewhere in the middle. That's really the high-low game. We always end up somewhere in that middle. So fatigue sets in, the deal falls apart, or one side caves, and no one is real happy at the end. Let me give you one other quick activity. I want everybody to pick a partner, just one partner, and I want one of you to be the provider and one to be the recipient. I'm gonna give you 10 bucks. I'm not really giving you 10 bucks, I'm too cheap. But I'm gonna give you 10 bucks, and the provider has the $10, And you're going to make one offer and one offer only to the receiver. And whatever that offer is, the receiver can accept or reject it. If they reject it, both of you get zero. If they accept it, you have to take whatever was given. So I'm giving the providers 10 bucks. You give one offer to the receiver, and they can accept or reject it. But if they reject it, you get zero. All right, how many of you split the money $5 and $5? About half of you. What was the lowest amount that somebody got? $1. If you decline the offer, you both got zero. So here's the game. If I were the person giving the 10 bucks, some of you gave half and half because you felt it was fair to give 5 bucks, right? But even if I gave $1, if they didn't accept it, neither one of you got anything. So reality is, for that person receiving it, they should have said yes to the dollar, because it's $1 or zero. Even if you don't think it's fair, it's the best deal you have because the alternative is zero. All right, so that brings us over to BATNA, best alternative to a negotiated agreement. A BATNA is not your ideal outcome. You've got to determine what is best, the best you can do without a negotiated agreement, what alternatives exist, and that becomes your fallback position. So on that $10 bill, your fallback position from $1 is nothing. So if you don't take it, you're walking away with nothing. While it's not the perfect or ideal outcome, it's something you can obtain without an agreement the other party is negotiating with you. If you don't identify alternatives, you may accept or reject a transaction which is not in your best interest. You've got to focus on your best alternative. What's my alternative to make something work? And that's what a BATNA really is. It's not the ideal outcome. It's your best option if you can't get a negotiated deal together. It helps to remove the emotion and prevent a party from rejecting a term that may be better than the alternative. So we've got to find our BATNA. We've got to research, list, and evaluate all the alternatives. We've got to eliminate those alternatives that aren't feasible, and it's going to enhance your negotiating power, and you know what you're going to walk away from. So we first identify alternatives to our current negotiation. We flesh out each of those alternatives, and I'm going to show you some in a minute. Determine the positives and negatives and transform it into a practical option. And all of these are suboptimal, but you select the best option or options and use them to determine what your reserve price is. So what's my BATNA? Let's say I've got a building for sale and I've got 5 offers on it. And one of them stands out as the highest number, but there's some terms I really don't like. If I can't get those terms to work, what's my alternative? I've got 5 offers and one's pretty high. What's my alternative? Take the next best offer, right? Well, the other option is possibly to put it back on the market, but the real answer is probably take the next highest. So no matter what I'm able to negotiate with this particular person, I know what my bottom line is because I know what the next best offer is. Let's say we've got a person who purchased a commercial investment property 5 years ago for $500,000. It's now empty, the tenants have moved out, rents have gone down in the area because it's office space and everybody moved into their homes. But it could rent for $3,500 a month. We owe $350,000 on it. We've got an offer on the table of $450,000. We'd like to sell it, but we're not gonna sell it below that $500,000 threshold. If we can't sell it for $500,000, if we can't get this buyer up to the number we need, what's our next best alternative? It's probably renting it. You could try and sell the property as low as $350,000 and pay off the loan, but the reality is you probably are gonna rent it or keep looking for another buyer. Or you could burn it down for the insurance proceeds, although you'll probably end up in jail. And if you've got a friend, then you're gonna put you in 2 different rooms. So third example, you've got a 10,000 square foot real estate office and all of your agents have gone virtual since COVID. You're paying overhead for space you can't use and you wanna relocate the less space, but you don't wanna give away the building. So you've got a lot of options. You could lease the building instead of selling it. You can lease out part of the building and keep the rest of it for yourself. You can go back to somebody who may have made you an offer last year on it or a neighboring property and see what they'll pay you for it. Or you can decide to do nothing and not move. There's always alternatives and you have to look for them. We've got a hotel impacted by COVID. We've had a lot of these lately. And I'm significantly behind on my mortgage, but the value is way down. It was worth $4 million 2 years ago, now it's worth $2 million. I owe $3.5 million. Because the occupancy rate has declined, I can't sell it for as much as it was worth last year. So what are my alternatives? And you have to think through them. My alternative might be to file bankruptcy. That may be my best choice. I've got to figure out what the risks and rewards of bankruptcy are. I might try and negotiate a short sale, and get out of the debt with a short sale. That might be better or worse than a bankruptcy. I've got to figure that out. I might have to take on a partner or merge with someone. This might not work for a hotel, but maybe you've got two salons or two gyms and maybe you merge them together. You try and work something out. Or maybe I borrow money to weather the economy at a higher interest rate. We've got to figure out what all of our alternatives are so that we have something to fall back on. If you don't identify alternatives, you may accept or reject a transaction which is not in your best interest. Now I'm going to talk about how to actually do a negotiation step by step, but I want to point out a lot of the material from Harvard is free online. They have a ton of information. They've got a free newsletter. They've got a lot of free booklets that they'll be happy to send you. Oxford has some too. And that Book of Yes comes out of this group at Harvard Law School. It's wonderful information, lots of great ideas. It's what CCIM's program came from for negotiation. What I have up here is their Masterclass, their negotiation journal, negotiation skills, negotiation strategies for women, getting the deals done, and BATNA are some of the free reports that they have that you can listen to. Getting to Yes, again, one of the best-selling books in the country, lays out seven components of negotiation. Now, I'm going to tweak these a little bit as we go forward. But it starts with trying to focus on interests instead of positions. And this is challenging because you're trying to get not just your interests, but the other party's interests as well. And I'm going to talk about how to do that. Because again, traditional negotiation, you want $500,000, I want to pay you $450,000. And we get into a war back and forth to try and get to a point where probably neither one of us is real happy. So we try and focus on the interests, not on what position they're taking. We've got to identify all the stakeholders, clarify their interests, and probe for underlying interests. That's number one. Number two is options. What are possible agreements or bits of an agreement? Create options and find ways to maximize joint gains. Alternatives, a good outcome should be better than any alternative. So always have your BATNA in the background so you know what your baseline is. What's my worst case scenario? What happens if I can't get an agreement? Number four is legitimacy. You don't want to be unfairly treated, neither does the other side. So we've got to find external standards to determine fairness. What criteria will be used to show both parties the terms are fair? When we're selling a transaction, we're selling a property. An appraisal has nothing to do with the buyer, has nothing to do with the seller. It's a fair assessment of the value of the property, right? So we have to go back to something like that. If we're a real estate firm trying to buy another real estate firm, we've got to find a fair way to come up with something that is a third party that isn't necessarily one of you trying to push the other to do something. Number five is communication. Am I ready to listen and talk effectively? Do we have preconceived assumptions about the other side? I need to question my assumptions and listen to them and reframe them to understand my position. Number six is relationship. Now, part of the problem in real estate is we don't want to fight with the other side that much because frankly, we're going to be working with them again, aren't we? I had a buyer's agent that worked with us in commercial real estate about 15, 20 years ago, and she was overly aggressive, really, really aggressive. And she was able to beat down everybody on the other side one after another until nobody wanted to work with her. And we've got to work with these people over and over again. And maybe you're not trying to negotiate with another realtor. Maybe you're negotiating with a buyer or a seller or an investor. How many other properties does that investor have? And by the way, that investor has other friends that are investors too, and other property owners and other commercial landlords. And if you create an enemy here, you're going to have that problem going forward with others. So don't take positions personally. Don't focus on personality. Separate people from the substantive issues and prepare a good working relationship. And commitment, the quality of outcome is directly related to the quality of the promises we make. What commitments should I make or seek? And identify the issues to be included in agreement. Now these get boiled down to four core principles of what we call interest-based approach to negotiations. This is what CCIM's negotiation course is based on. An alternative to traditional negotiation, they focus on the interest of the parties, not their positions. Number one is separate people from the problem. Don't focus on them or their personality. How many of you have negotiated with somebody that you really don't like? Don't let that affect how you're going to negotiate. Number two is focus on interests and motivations, and we're going to try and figure out how to discover what their interests really are, not positions. We're going to look for creative ways to create mutual gains. And number four, insist on using objective standards and appraisal. or objective criteria to try and figure out how we're going to come to a resolution. Get what we need while sustaining long-term relationships. Now, this is what we call interest-based negotiation. Collaboration. We're trying to create win-win negotiation. We're trying to create a mutual benefit. We're trying to negotiate in a principled manner, communicate openness, authenticity, and creativity, present information in a clear manner, avoid compromises, because unsatisfying compromises can lead to damaged ego, dissatisfaction, and conflict, and it requires a creative approach. So when we're looking for success, we're trying to implement a negotiated contract, but we want our relationship maintained and enhanced through the process, and we want each party to have some important gains. Now, I can say that, most of you say, that sounds great, Loren, but I gotta tell you, I've been in a lot of negotiations and I've been dealing with slime. And how can we put this into work and practice? It might be nice to say you wanna be the good guy and you wanna get a fair transaction, you wanna use objective standards and you wanna care about their needs and create a win-win, but how do we actually get to that point? Again, we focus, and we do it too much on positions. Think about it when you argue with your spouse. You can be totally wrong and argue a position. I'm listening to people still arguing positions on either side of the political aisle from 2 years ago. How about COVID? How many people are on both sides of that issue? And it doesn't matter what kind of data comes out, each side digs in. Each side knows they're right and they're gonna argue it to the end of the earth. We're focusing too much on positions. We've gotta separate people from the problem, focus on interests, not positions. Create options for a larger pie, a mutual gain, and use creative criteria trying to put something together. Now, I want to back up a second. How many of you have read 7 Habits of Highly Effective People? A lot of you. If you haven't read it, it's probably 25 years old now. It's a fantastic book. I'm going to focus on 3 of those principles today real quickly. Begin with the end in mind, think win-win, and seek first to be understood, and then be understood. Begin with the end in mind. One of the most powerful techniques I was taught a long time ago, when we're doing a 3-day workshop, a 3-day event, sometime during that 3-day event, we hopefully give a lot of ideas and concepts that you're going to be able to apply. Now, in those ideas and concepts, we want you to really apply them. And the problem is you all leave, and you're happy, and you're going, rah, rah, and you get home, and you don't do it because something else gets in the way. So what we do is we have you write a letter to yourself, a page or two, during the workshop. And that letter is going to be addressed to you a year from now. And it says, I am so excited. You have to put emotion in it. I am so excited. I was able to accomplish this. I was able to get my sales up by 28% or whatever that goal you have is. I was able to lose 25 pounds. And this is how I did it. And this is how it makes me feel, because I want to get to the emotion. I want to get to the red. That helps you to focus what you're going to be. Focus from the point you're going to be, not the point you are now. Everything you do has to be focused from the point you want to be at. So when we're looking at a negotiation, we want something that's going to win for both parties so that we have a good relationship later. In order to do that, we need to get them listening to us. And we can't get them listening to us if we're not listening to them. So seek first to understand and then be understood. Now, this is CCIM's layout. I'm going to tweak it a lot. There are 3 steps of CCIM interest-based negotiations: is who is involved in the transaction and what do they need? What actions can be taken to satisfy everyone's needs? And by the way, this is correct. I just want to add a few more steps. And 3, what happens if there's no negotiation that's reached? Who's involved? What can we do to satisfy their needs? And what happens if it all falls apart? The problem we deal with is none of us ever see the full picture, not even with our spouses, right? We only sometimes see the tip of the iceberg. Each party's interest is often invisible to the other party, but it's a critical component of their position. We need to understand their underlying interests so we can find those areas of mutual gain. Now, you've probably heard this one before. This is an old story, and it's kind of simplistic, but I want to get it across. So Bobby and Cindy Brady want an orange. There's only one in the house. Mrs. Brady cuts the orange in half and gives each person half, each of them half of the orange, and both are unhappy, and she asks why. And the answer is Cindy wanted the entire orange because she was going to bake a cake and she needed the peel of one entire orange. And Bobby just wanted the fruit in order to eat it. If Mrs. Brady focused on positions, the orange would be split in half. If she focuses on their interests, each one achieves a more satisfactory result. I know this is simplistic, but I'm trying to get across that sometimes there's creative solutions that we can come up with to put them together. The sum of the parts is greater than the whole. That's Aristotle. It's been around a long, long time. So my negotiation process, step by step, we start with research, smile, pay a sincere compliment, ask for their opening bid, actively listen, prompt with calibrated questions, label, paraphrase, and parrot, discover their wants and needs, obtain incremental agreements, find pain points, and create a win-win situation. I'm gonna come back to that slide again for those of you who missed that. I'm gonna do that in a little bit more detail. So every negotiation, all of them, have opposing interests. All of them have shared interests. We've gotta find those. They're simply different paradigms. One of Stephen Covey's stories that was pretty interesting, I don't think it's in this book, I think it's in a different one, is that there's a man on a train. I don't know if you've heard this one, so please forgive me, but there's a man on a train. His little son is 3 or 4 years old, is running up and down the train. Train's going from DC up to New York. And the kid is bothering everybody on the train and driving them crazy. And what everybody sees is this guy who is not disciplining his son. And because of that, everybody else is suffering. They can't get work done. They're on the phone, they're trying to do stuff, and he's bothering them. So eventually one woman comes up and says, "Will you please control your son?" And he says, "I'm sorry, I didn't even realize, I didn't even notice. You know, I'm coming from the hospital. My wife just died, and I don't know what to do." We all have different paradigms. We all have different viewpoints of where we are in our life and what we see. And we come at it from that perspective. That's why we've got different viewpoints on politics, and why we have different viewpoints on COVID and everything else. We've got to figure out how to get to that emotion to understand it a little bit better. So the first step in any negotiation is to be prepared. You've got to learn everything you can about the other side. You have to figure out who is in charge, who are the stakeholders and what do they need. Be expecting what the other party will ask. Some of those questions that they're gonna ask you are gonna be hard questions. Will you list it for a 3.5% commission? Will you list it for $1 million? I know it's only worth 500,000, but we can always come down, we can't come up, right? You all heard those questions? So be prepared to answer those questions and prepare to use techniques to uncover hidden wants and emotions behind the other party. If we're doing land development, there's two times we do due diligence, maybe three. Before we write an offer, big property comes on the market, it's a corner. Let's say I represent Wawa. Big corner property's coming on the market, Wawa's gonna want it, I know they are. I've gotta tie up that property. But before I do anything, I've gotta find out really quick whether it's probably gonna go through. So the first thing I'm gonna do is quick call the zoning office and find out whether or not they're gonna allow a gas station. I'm also gonna pull a deed on it and make sure there's no deed restrictions against it, and I'm gonna make sure that they're not having any easement problems or any other restrictions on it. Those are the things I'm gonna do. I've only got 12, maybe 24 hours to do that. Then I put in a letter of intent, and I do a much longer due diligence once I tie up that property, because I'm afraid CVS is gonna come in and take that property out from under me. So I've got two periods. Before I get a commitment, before I actually get any sort of contract to start negotiating, and after I've got a contract. Same thing happens when you're trying to negotiate anything, whether it's a sale or a listing, or whether you're trying to negotiate a lawsuit. It's all about doing your homework. You've got to have that initial investigation into what's happening, and then as you go through the negotiation, you're going to add to your knowledge base. So you're going to practice techniques for teasing out information, and remember that the secret to negotiation is giving the other side the illusion of control. That may sound really harsh, but it's true. If somebody feels like they're in control, they're more likely to be open to you, aren't they? So we want to give them that feeling of control, that feeling of power. And to us, what is powerful is knowledge. The negotiator who has the most information and asks the most questions has the advantage in a negotiation. So if they trust you, they feel better about the process, they're more open to discussion. If they think you're hearing them, they will hear you. It's really critical. So stakeholders, we've got to figure out who they are. Who has the decision-making power for the transaction? Who is essential to closing the transaction and may potentially veto it? How many of you have dealt with a CEO of a company? You thought they could make a decision, but they can't because the board of directors does. Or you're dealing with a person who you think owns the building, but their spouse is really the person who's controlling it. Happens a lot. We need to know who actually is controlling. We need to know who the stakeholders are, what's important to each one, and where we might have interests that are in alignment and where we might have interests in opposition. So again, I'm bringing this back to CCIM, but they've got a really good interest analysis chart where they put the issues down one side and all the stakeholders across. And we try and fill it in and figure out where we're aligned so we can work on the other parts. And even if we have parts that are separate, we might be able to work on exactly how we might be able to work closer together. So we've got a landlord and a tenant. Maybe we've got five parties. Maybe we've got a zoning officer. Maybe we've got the city that wants to have more jobs in the area. And where we're in alignment is they're both agreed to the rental rate and they both want a good working relationship. The tenant doesn't want the landlord to go bankrupt. The landlord doesn't want the tenant to go bankrupt. But the landlord wants your store to be in line and you want an end cap. But the landlord knows they want Starbucks in that end cap because it'll attract more tenants. The tenant wants 6,000 in tenant improvements. The landlord only wants to give 2,500. The tenant wants parking spaces guaranteed. The tenant wants a specific Century 21 franchise sign as opposed to their generic real estate sign that the landlord wants on the building. And free rent period, 60 days for the landlord, 120 for the tenant. We've got to figure that out, but if we can at least get an idea where they're coming from, we can see where we're in alignment and where we have problems. So what might the tenant's BATNA be? The tenant's BATNA might be to go to a different space. If they can't get this worked out, what's the next best space for them to negotiate? If I'm the landlord, what's the landlord's next BATNA? Well, either letting them actually take the space in the end cap or to have another tenant come in, to find the next tenant. So we've got to try and figure that out. Now again, in CCIM, they actually use a system called Numeral. It's very similar to what I've used in the past. We have to figure out each person's needs, urgency, motivation, expectation, resources, authority, and loyalty. But what I look at it as is we need their wants and needs. Who are the stakeholders? Who has the authority to approve a transaction? What do they want? What do they need? What's their urgency? If they have to be in a building, sometimes we have a little bit more leverage. If they have to sell tomorrow, they're in bankruptcy, they're going to go to sheriff's sale in 60 days. You as the buyer have leverage, right? But you need to understand that. What's their motivation? Why are they looking for a deal? I've had a lot of brokers come to me and say, hey, I'm interested in selling this franchise, this business. And you look at the numbers and they're not quite right. And you try and massage them and try and understand where they're coming from. And you realize they're hemorrhaging a lot. And that's why they're selling. Why they say they're selling is completely different than what you're actually looking at. But any business is like that, right? What resources do they have? Why are they looking for a deal? What are their expectations? And are all parties working in an ethical manner? Because people lie, right? That's something we've got to deal with. We try and figure out what actions we can take to satisfy everybody's needs and seek creative solutions to make that happen. To understand their needs, if we are actually able to understand their needs, we're sometimes able to create situations that we didn't realize we had. I need $10 million for this building. Ken is only willing to pay me $8 million. And we go back and forth and back and forth and we at an impasse. And Ken says to me, why are you looking at selling? Because I had this manufacturing plant and now I'm having everything made overseas and I don't need this big manufacturing plant, but I still need an office. And being at my age, I'm looking at getting to retirement. I need to get rid of this and put some money in the bank to keep me going. And I've got to have a smaller space. And I'm going to have to pack up all this stuff and move down the street, move into another building. I need money for that move. And I need money to pay the rent, and rent's expensive these days. So Ken will say to me, you know what, Loren? I'll buy it for $8 million, but I'm going to carve out 30% of this building and I'm going to rent it to you under rate. Less than you would be paying down the street, and you have no moving costs. That's a sale leaseback, right? We do that sort of thing all the time when we find out what the real motivation is, not the position that I'm willing to take 10 and Ken's willing to pay me 8. Seller financing. I need $10 million for this building because I'm going to put it into CDs because I'm retired and I need that income. Well, I'll tell you what, borrowing money right now on commercial loans, how much are you paying on commercial loans right now? So you're paying 8 or 9%. So maybe we turn around and we say, listen, you're gonna get 4% for putting your money into something else. I'll pay you 5.5% and you hold the loan, you hold the note. Seller financing. We don't know that unless we understand what the real motivation is. And partnerships come out of this too, don't they? Sometimes we find some interesting partnerships. So we're gonna use a little bit of psychology or develop human nature based skills is what we're looking at. Again, we are emotional and irrational, but we are emotional and irrational in predictable ways. How many of you think the market is going to go down in the next 12 months? Now, I know there are some pockets that are hot, there's some pockets that are cold, but as a whole in the country, how many of you think the market's gonna go down in the next 12 months? So probably about 70% of you. How many think it's gonna go up? Some of you do. All right, fine. How many of you have buyers who think that we just hit 2008 and everything's gonna be dropping by half by June? I'm hearing that all the time, aren't you? Well, it's 2008 all over again. I can offer half, can't I? How many of you have sellers who are telling you that by May 1st, prices are gonna go up another 5% because they've heard it? And by the way, you can find news articles about both of these. During COVID, one of my favorite articles was written by the Los Angeles Times, where they predicted, as soon as the quarantines lifted, that housing prices would drop by half right after COVID. How many of you saw prices drop by half after COVID? You can find articles that'll tell you absolutely anything you wanna hear. People have emotions and we've gotta deal with that. So we're gonna use psychology effectively. We're gonna focus on their emotions. We're always gonna remain calm and try and calm others. We're gonna try and establish a connection, some rapport. We're gonna get people to verbalize their wants and needs using a couple of techniques. And we're gonna try and help them to be understood. What matters most in negotiation is what each side wants and needs, not the position they're taking. And getting their wants and needs is establishing trust. So how do I do that? I'm gonna ask some open-ended questions. I'm gonna paraphrase back what they said to make sure I understand it. And I'm gonna do a few other things. So back in the 1990s, there were three big real estate trainers. There was Floyd Wickman, the Sweat Hogs. How many of you heard of Sweat Hogs? There was Mike Ferry, no, not Tom Ferry, Mike Ferry. And there was Joe Stumpf who did the main event. And Joe did a lot of stuff where he talked about emotion. And the fact that we tend to think with our hearts instead of our minds. People buy and sell emotionally. We buy and sell for pain or pleasure. Why do we diet? We diet because our joints hurt. Not because we don't want pizza. I love pizza. I was at Margaritaville last night. Our joints hurt, that's pain. We wanna be attractive to others, that's pleasure. Because we wanna be healthy, that can be either. Or because our wife tells us we have to lose weight, either way. But we do it for pain or pleasure. And one of the things Joe said is that your client is either running from pain or fear, or they're running toward pleasure or something desirable. And getting the answer is only the tip of the iceberg to help them alleviate the pain or realize the pressure. Once you identify the most critical factors in a party's motivation, you can address those issues. I was part of a mastermind group with Joe Stumpf. Now, I'll segue slightly for a second. How many of you know Brian Buffini? How many of you think Brian Buffini is awesome? Back in the 90s, Joe Stumpf had a pretty interesting mastermind group. And I was part of it, and Tim was part of it, and Teresa was part of it, and Brian Buffini sat between us. He had just segued from ERA to RE/MAX and was trying to figure out how to make his next deal. And part of that group, Brian went on to be one of the top two trainers in the country currently. Joe Niego, of course, is speaking all over the country. He was one of them. Dean Jackson has the incredible podcast, More Cheese, Less Whiskers. If you haven't tried that, check it out, More Cheese, Less Whiskers. Some great people. And then, of course, me. I, of course, have to work for drinks from Randy because that's all I can really do. I'm coming around to a point, and I'll get back to this in a second. So Brian, interestingly enough, was doing some keynote speeches all over the place. And I was lucky enough to speak behind him at three events in a row. Brian, by the way, is awesome. He's fantastic to listen to. If you haven't listened to him, watch him online. He's just incredible. So he comes out at the first convention I'm at, and we're running late because we're always running late, aren't we? And he taps on his watch, and he says, we're behind. I'm not sure what to do. What I was going to do was this, but maybe I'll do this, maybe I'll do that. What do you think of this? And somebody answers a question. And he responds to that, and then he gets a dialogue going in the audience. And he responds so incredibly effectively, and then he starts talking, and he brings it all back around to the first thing he said. And I thought, that was masterful. It was the best dialogue I've ever seen in my entire life. It's incredible. I've never seen anything like it. And so then I go to the next convention, and he comes out, and he taps his wrist and says, we're out of time. I was going to do this, but I was going to do that. What do you think about, and somebody answers the right way. And he says the same thing. And he goes through this incredible dialogue a second time. I'm thinking, I heard this. And I get to the third convention. And he comes out and says, we're running out of time. I'm thinking, this is unbelievable. No, he does not have a plant in the audience. Here's the thing. If you have enough people in the room, somebody's going to answer you the right way. And that's called practice, drill, and rehearse. Everything you do is practice, drill, and rehearse, right? When you go out on a listing appointment, you know that they're going to ask you about commission, they're going to ask you about price, there are certain things they're always going to ask you. They don't want to paint the walls or put in carpeting because let the next person do it, I've invested enough. We've all heard that? Negotiation's the same way. Everything you have to do, you've got to practice, drill, and rehearse. What Brian does amazingly well is he practices, drills, and rehearses to the point where everything's perfect. So anyway, back to Joe Stumpf. Joe had this system that he thought was fantastic called the 5-6-7 method. He wanted to get you to find out the emotion behind any transaction. Is the client running from pain or fear, or they're running toward pleasure? And the idea was to ask 7 questions in a row as to why that's important to you, to get them to answer what's really important about that transaction. And this was the example he used, and it was a great example, so I tried it, which I'll explain in a minute. Why do you want to sell and buy a property? Well, we want a bigger house. Okay, why is that important to you? Well, the kids are getting older, we need more room. And most of us don't go beyond that, do we? Really, I understand that. But why is more room important to you? Well, the kids really need their own space away from each other. Okay, thanks. Can you explain what you mean by space away from each other? Well, Kyle plays the drums and the noise is elevating tension in the house between the kids. We need a basement or a place away from other family members, maybe a garage. If you can get to that emotion, you can actually understand them better and you can start addressing it. Now, I thought this was wonderful and I went back and did the biggest mistake, one of the bigger mistakes in my career. So I got back to the office and thought, this is fantastic. I'm gonna ask this question constantly. So first couple of calls, he says, we wanna sell our building. I get out there, I sit down at the conference table with him, and the husband and wife, and the husband's sitting there, arm out around the wife's chair. Why do you want to sell? Well, we're getting tired and old with this place. We're going to sell, and then we're going to wait a little bit. We're going to find the right deal. We're going to buy something else. Really? Why is that important to you? Well, like I said, this is older, and we want something newer, more up-to-date, and so forth. Why is it important to you? I got around number 4 or 5, and he stood up and said, because she slept with every one of my friends. And she stood up and said, I had vanilla, and I wanted the other 31 flavors. And she ran in one room crying, and he ran in the other room crying. And I sat there going, what did I do? So I used the sandbag clothes. I sat there because I didn't know what else to do until they eventually came out. I did list the property, I did sell the property, and both of them referred business. But I never used it exactly that way again. But the truth is, you do have to get to that emotion. Now, why do people lie? Anybody have an idea why people lie? Because everybody does it. So some of the ones I put down are embarrassment or hurt. Some people lie to gain an advantage, to win a negotiation. Some people have pride. I want to sell this real estate company that I've built up for 25 years. I'm hemorrhaging money out the back door. But I want to sell this real estate company. I want to tell everybody, boy, I did such a wonderful job. I don't really want to see the numbers, do I? That sort of thing happens. And sometimes we lie to avoid illegal activity. How are we going to actually get information out of them? We're going to use some tools. One is called active listening. One is open-ended questions. One's negative questions, which I'm going to have a little fun with. One is called labeling, paraphrasing and parroting, effective pauses, and incremental agreements. Now, again, this is my steps to negotiation. I'm going to research first. I'm going to try and find out as much as I can up front. Then I'm going to get there and I'm going to smile. Why do we smile? Because we all try and look professional and we look like we're mad. We look like we're frowning. When we smile, people smile back. There's a study done that we are 31% more impactful with our thought process when we're smiling. And they actually did the study and they made the people in the study put a pencil between their teeth and not touch the pencil with their lips. It's a fake smile. They were still able to process information faster with a fake smile than they were without. We gotta smile, we've gotta create that. And every time we go out today, I want you to smile at everybody you see because this is a really important thing that we're not doing. Then we need to pay them a sincere compliment. We want them to like and trust us. Those are the building blocks of friendship. Wow, this is a lovely lobby. Did you decorate it yourself? Did you design it? Everyone says such wonderful things about you. We're triggering chemicals in their brain that make them feel good and helps to build that connection. We also then, we smile, we pay a sincere compliment, we ask them for their bid. Now I know that creates an anchor. I know that can be a problem sometimes, but we want to know where they are. It can be a problematic thing. And sometimes when they lay that anchor down, that open offer, they refuse to move, they dig in. But again, We need to have an understanding of where they're coming from so that we can respond to them. We want them talking. So when we're on listing appointments, we try and get them to open up. We all do, I think. Give the other party the ability to say what they're looking for, but they may not answer. So you keep repeating and reframing it. How much do you want for this building? It's a beautiful building. How much do you want for it? Well, that's your job, isn't it? Well, about 30% of them will answer. About 70% won't. So a little bit later, you go back and you say, how much do you think your building's worth? And some of them will answer again. Have you had a recent appraisal done lately? Yes, but it was so low. Oh, really? How low was it? Now you have a pretty good idea what they're looking for. Have you seen other buildings like yours that have sold recently, and how do you think they compare with yours? By the time you're done, you'll get 80 or 90% of the answers. And it gives you the ability to start responding to their opening bid, their interpretation. If you have to make an opening bid, the two suggestions I make are to give a range instead of a number. Well, properties like this are selling between $850,000 and $900,000. But I have to really narrow it down. Or the second idea is to take it slightly off the table. This is the CMA approach. Well, there was a property down here that sold for this. It was a little bigger than yours. And let them respond to you. Because we try and get an understanding of what they're really looking for. You can do the same thing with any negotiation on a sale. You're trying to get them to talk. Once they start talking, you've got to actively listen. This is probably the hardest part of anything. Listening is not passive. Again, Stephen Covey, seek first to understand and then be understood. Why actively listen? Most of us miss two-thirds of what the other side says because we're thinking about what we're going to say next. We're preoccupied with our position. Two-thirds of you did not hear that sentence. Two-thirds of you are thinking about, I'd like another cookie, or I wonder what my kids are doing upstairs. Lots of things you're thinking about, or this deal that you're struggling with. You're thinking about that instead of actually actively listening. We do it because we want to show the other side we care. It's really important. It's the most important thing you can do in negotiation is listen to them. The best way to find pain points and to find an area of compromise or agreement is to really listen. And I'm going to show you how to build that into your system. And frankly, none of the techniques I'm going to teach you next don't work unless you're not listening. And really good listeners only hear 60 to 65% of what you say. When people start with our firm, I have them listen to a workshop. Actually, I've listened to a lot of workshops. But there's one from a Century 21 convention in New Orleans a bunch of years ago named Rick DeLuca. Great, interesting 75-minute workshop that overview of the real estate industry. I have them listen to it when they first start in the first 30 days. And then I have them listen to it in month 13. And they hear completely different stuff. Because we don't hear everything that's said. We never do. And we've got to try to figure out how we can hear more of what they're saying so that we can try and use that to try and build a connection. Stephen Covey said there are five levels of listening. Ignoring, pretend listening, we're patronizing, we're talking to ourselves in our own head. And selective listening, we listen up to a point where we have our answer, our rebuttal. We're arguing politics and we're letting the other side talk for a minute until they say something that we want to respond to. And we'll let them keep talking, but we don't hear anything else because we know what we're going to respond to. We listen for problem solvings, we listen to rebut, but we're not listening to the emotion. Attentive listening is level four, listening for why they're saying it and why it matters to them, and trying to understand the other party. And the way we're going to do this is paraphrase back what they said. And then there's empathetic listening. Focus on the other person's frame of reference. Listen for what they are not saying, find the emotions, and get to their internal logic. Now, I do want to tell you, empathy is not compassion. We can empathize with their position. I don't care what side of the political aisle you're on. If you're really good at it, you can empathize with their position. Doesn't mean you have to agree with it. Doesn't mean you have to compromise your principles. But you can show them that you care about their opinion, their perspective. You can understand their position without agreeing to it. Empathy can lead to insight and understanding, but it doesn't mean you agree with them. So the way we actively listen is we're going to ask open-ended questions. We're going to request clarification. We're going to be attentive. We're going to summarize what they said. If I'm really listening to you, I'm going to be able to parrot it back and I'm going to be able to paraphrase. So what I hear you saying is this. And then they're going to correct us or not going to correct us. I'm going to be able to paraphrase back to you and I'm going to do something called reflecting feelings, which I'll talk about in a minute. Because you want to be attuned to what they're actually feeling. You know when somebody's mad, don't you? Or you know when somebody you hit a nerve and they twitch? We want to be able to look for that and be able to bring that to light And we're going to ask probing questions. We're going to do all of that. And during this time, there are a few caveats. Put yourself in their shoes. Again, you don't have to agree with them, but put yourself in their shoes. Don't deduce their motives from your fears. They're trying to steal this hotel from me because I'm going bankrupt. I can't believe these people. I hate these people. Don't deduce their motives from your fears. Don't blame them for your problem. They aren't the reason that you're going bankrupt as a hotel. Discuss each perception. Give them a stake by getting them to participate and make your proposals consistent with their values. Now, we're going to get rid of yes-no questions. We want open-ended questions. We avoid, can you do this? Do you do that? Are you doing this? And we're going to use two words, how and what. Every question we use, we're going to try and use a how or a what, because you're going to get better answers. And you're going to introduce questions for negotiation. What's the biggest challenge you face? How about recruiting? What about this possible change is important to you? Now, how many of you, when you're recruiting, trying to talk to an agent, immediately go to, what's your commission split? Or here's what we offer. We're fantastic. We're great. We're Century 21. Biggest name in the world. Isn't that what we do? Too many of us? What's important to them? What about this possible change you're considering is important to you? How can I help to make it better for us? How would you like to proceed? How would you solve this problem? Get them talking one way or another. And you're going to prompt with calibrated open-ended questions. Use how questions to trigger their thoughts. Take the aggression out of the conversation. We're not going to say, there were new sales that came up. We're trying to tell somebody they're overpriced. There were new sales that came up and we were overpriced for the market. That's accusatory. Instead, allow your counterpart to see the ideas and requests without sounding overbearing or pushy. The latest property sales are lower in price per square foot than we're asking. How do you feel your property compares to theirs? Now, we all know they think theirs is the best in the world, but we want them to respond to us and make an analysis themselves because they start thinking about it. Once you figure out the direction you want the conversation to go, you design questions that ease the conversation in the direction you want to go, and while letting the other party think the choice to get there is theirs. And as we learn stuff, we're going to continue to fill out a stakeholder chart and try and figure out what's important to them and where we might be able to find some areas of compromise. Now, we are conditioned to say no. Dad, can I borrow the car keys? What's your answer to that every time? Now, 2 minutes later, you might come back and say, okay, because if I don't give you the car keys, you're going to ride with Randy, and Randy is a terrible driver. So it's probably safer for you to take my car. That's the type of thing we're looking at. One of my favorites, sorry to bother you, do you have a few minutes? I get calls all the time, by the way, from agents all over the country in areas I don't know, and they'll say, do you have a couple of minutes? I need to know how to price an airplane hangar. Your immediate answer in your head is, no, I really don't. I've got 15 things to do. What we want to do is try and turn that around. And we want to get them answering differently than a no, even if they reluctantly say yes here. So we're going to use the power of negative questions. Now, sales trainers for years have told us we've got to get 7 yeses to get an agreement, right? You've heard that from a lot of trainers. Can you see how selling the property for top dollar would benefit you? How about real estate recruiters? They all use the same scripts. Would you like to make more money? Would you like to spend more time with your family? Would you like to have so many leads that you don't have to worry about your mortgage and your car payment? Would you like to live in a bigger house? The idea is if you get enough of those soft yeses, you're going to get to a big yes. The problem is, we all know this, don't we? And not just salespeople know this, everybody knows this. And when they start hearing these types of questions, their defenses go up. Oh, not another one of these people trying to sell me on something. They're called logic traps. That's what they've always been called. We get small commitments and we trap someone into a yes. It's not working anymore. But everyone knows that. They become traps. People do not want to be sold. They want to buy, but they don't want to be sold. If we can change yes-oriented questions to no-oriented questions, we make people feel more secure, more comfortable, more at ease, and more in control of the choices they make. Is it crazy to think that you couldn't do 10% more business with a different strategy for your real estate practice? The answer to that is no. Instead of saying, would you like more income? Is it crazy to think you couldn't do 10% more business if you had the right strategy? An agent in their head says, no. And then they think about it and they come back with an answer. No, I guess it's not. I probably could do 10% more if my broker weren't holding me back. people start thinking a little bit more. Negative questions can often lead the other party to thinking more critically and gives them permission to be honest. They'll become more willing to listen. Is this proposal ridiculous? Or do you think I'm crazy even to suggest this? Would you be against? You need to get their reservations. You need to understand what their real problem is, what their real emotion is, what their real reservations are. Their hesitancy, what they fear. You want to get to that ready. You want to get to that emotion. So you repeat what you hear them say, you rephrase it, and then you go silent. By the way, anytime you repeat what somebody says and you want them to be connecting with you, don't ever use the word but. I hear what you're saying, my commission's too high, but don't say that. So what I hear you saying is you think my commission's too high. Let them explain it, because quite honestly, 50% of the time they're gonna talk themselves into a higher commission. Well, it was worth a shot. And you didn't say anything. This is Chris Voss. He wrote Never Split the Difference. His organization is called the Black Swan Organization. If you get a chance to see anything by them, they're amazing. He is the first person I saw use negative questions, and he used them to do hostage negotiation, but they work in any form of business. It works really well. Would you be against this? Does this seem ridiculous? Does it seem like a bad idea if we do this? Would it be unreasonable if we do that? Do you disagree? Instead of does this work for you, what about this works for you? Or what about this doesn't work for you? You have to give an answer. Don't say why in the world do you think your property is worth $1 million? It's accusatory. Instead, would it be unreasonable for you to tell us how you came up with that figure? I've tried this, it works a whole lot better. Would it be unreasonable for you to tell us how you came up with that figure? Don't say would this property work for you, because they are jumping up and down, they want it, but they don't want to tell you that, they don't want to say yes. So what about this property works for you and what doesn't? Negative questions that are open-ended. So the other techniques we're going to use are parroting, paraphrasing, and labeling. It's part of active listening. Our goals are to find out what the other party needs and build trust with them. We need to validate their wants and needs so they feel safe and have trust and therefore communicate. So there's four things we do, well, five if we count silence. Paraphrase, parrot, label, and minimal encouragement. Paraphrase is repeating back what you heard. Parroting is repeating the last couple of words they said, because they'll give you a different answer sometimes. Labeling is turning what the other party is feeling, their emotions, into description, and minimal encouragement is like, I see and go on. Now I'll get to a couple of these. Parroting, repeat the last few words of the other party as if you're thinking about them. Huh, sell it for less, because they're going to take it further. Give it a brief silence. Repeat the last couple of words that they say. Now, in Chris Voss's book, he actually talks about this, but he calls it mirroring. I don't call it mirroring, and I'll tell you why. Anybody who's been through certain sales training programs, particularly car sales, mirroring is a technique where you act like the client. So if they talk quickly, you speed up. If they talk slowly, you slow down. If they have arms crossed, you cross your arms. If they lean back, you lean back. Because unconsciously, they see what you're doing, and unconsciously, they find a connection. That's what we usually call mirroring. In Chris Voss's book, he calls parroting back what they say as mirroring. I'm just saying take the last three or four or five words that they said, if it's something significant, and just say them out loud as soon as they're done, and let them expand on it. They hear you listening to them, and they actually may give you a little bit more. Paraphrasing is not parroting. It helps you focus on what they're saying, and it gives them the opportunity to confirm and to understand that you're hearing them. If you were to hire my team, I'm listing a property, if you were to hire my team, what would it take for me not just to be adequate, but to be exceptional? I've used this line 100 times. They all say the same thing. Sell my property. You write that down. You say, sell my property. I'm parroting it back. And you give it a silence of about 3 seconds. That's all you'll need. Because they're going to say something else. They always do. Well, you know, my cousin had this problem. Or we had this problem last time. Or, you know, I don't like this about realtors. They'll tell you what they really need. It's parroting back the last couple of words that you said. Now, when we're trying to figure out how to get through to a client, we wanted them to talk to us, we want them to trust and like us, and we want them to tell us what the real emotion is so that we can address it. There are barriers that we have to a successful negotiation, and part of it is negative emotions. We're scared going into negotiation. We're scared listing a property. And negative emotions constrict our ability to think critically, and we can't tell them to put a pencil in their teeth and hold their lips apart from it. So we've got to find a way to get them more comfortable. Fear paralyzes our ability to think, and it puts up barriers. The amygdala, which is your reptile brain, down at the bottom, controls almost everything you do. Not your thinking brain on the top, but your reptile brain. It's your immediate instinct, it's your emotion. And that is part of what causes so many challenges when we dig in. We need to quiet that part of the brain. And we do that by identifying their emotion and saying it out loud. That's called labeling. We're describing their emotion. We're using verbal observations to tease out whatever their concerns are. So we're going to show the party we understand them by labeling their emotion. It sounds like something's bothering you. Can we tell when something's bothering somebody? Okay, what happens when our spouse says, "Nothing, dear"? We do know when something's bothering somebody. When we're on a listing appointment, when we're on our sale, we're negotiating. So bring it out. Bring the elephant into the room, put it on the table, because you're going to eliminate that fear. You're going to bring it way down. It sounds like something is bothering you. You're trying to get them to address an unanswered question. And again, never use "but." Labels can neutralize negative emotions instantly, and labels can reinforce positive emotions. Your daughter comes home from school or comes home from a play. Love the play. You can see she's happy. "Oh, seems like you really enjoyed the play." That sets the neural pathways going, makes them feel even better. So we increase that positive, we try and silence the negative. We need to reduce the price. I tell that to a client. "You said we could sell my property for $1 million. How do you respond? "You feel that I failed you." Don't say, "I don't want you to think I let you down." Empathy has nothing to do with reality. It's what the other side's perspective is, not their paradigm. Their paradigm is. The elephant in the room becomes a lot less of a problem once we identify that elephant. "You feel I failed you." And they're gonna say, "No." That's normally what'll happen. And by the way, the level comes way down, doesn't it? Saying "you feel like I let you down" is not an admission that you did something wrong. It's also not a rebuttal. It's neither. Don't say "I'm sorry" because they don't care if you're sorry. Because that doesn't solve the problem. The property's still not sold. It seems like you feel my commission is not justified. Let them respond. Label the emotion in the room. Then we're gonna frame responses. When we're responding to people, we use the framing effect. And this gets into the weeds a little bit, so I don't wanna get into this too much. But some pretty interesting people, Daniel Kahneman, a psychologist, Amos Tversky, an economist, wrote the framing effect back in the 70s, and they actually got a Nobel Prize. And the idea is, from their studies, that people respond differently to the same choice depending on how it's posed or framed. Have you had an issue sometimes where you offer something to somebody and they say no, and the next person offers the exact same thing and they say yes? Depending on how something is framed, they react differently. So examples of reframing a question: would you be willing to do this? Are you against this? Does it seem like a bad idea to do this? Would it be unreasonable to do this? We're again reframing it as negative. Instead of saying, "Does this work for you?" how would you think this would work for you, not work for you? And some of the other things we're gonna do are incremental agreements. We can agree on parking and signage and free rent, but we're focusing on loss versus gain. What would they lose if they don't take this agreement? One of the other things that these two gentlemen wrote is the certainty effect. The avoidance of risk of loss is a more powerful motivator than the chance of gain. The certainty effect is the tendency of people to feel disproportionately better about outcomes that are certain than they do compare to outcomes that are possible. Avoiding pain is a much more powerful negotiator, or a much more powerful feeling than the opportunity for gain. I might make $1 million, but I might lose $2. Well, okay, that's an extreme example. But whatever we're going to lose there becomes our impetus not to do something. Fear of loss is more powerful than the opportunity for gain. So we have risk aversion. We don't sell our building that's going down in price because we don't want to sell it for under what we paid. In fact, it works in the stock market too. You've got a stock that you bought for $100, it's down at 20, and you still don't sell it because you're hoping it comes back. Now, what I would say is, if it's going to come back, buy a lot more of it. But if not, you've got to cut off that loss. We have that aversion to risk. Now, when I talk about these tactics, I don't want you to think we're trying to manipulate people, because we're not. Floyd Wigman said, "I never got a Christmas card from a prospect, only somebody I techniqued." And it's funny, because when Floyd Wigman was doing Sweat Hogs and Joe Stumpf was doing the main event, they would say things about other trainers that work differently. Because Joe Stumpf talked about offering exceptional service, and and trying to talk from the heart. And Floyd Wickman said, you've got to know everything you're saying, and you've got to be scripted very, very well. And I think you need a little bit of both. But it's true. I only got a Christmas card from, never from a prospect, only somebody I techniqued. We try and help people. And sometimes we have to use tactics to help them. He also said the difference between manipulation and helping people is get what they want is intent. What are we intending to do? Are we manipulating people? So if I have a child on drugs and I can use psychology to get best outcome for that child, would I do it? We have to use empathy to build trust and trust-based influence, and we've got to try and use that to build a win-win scenario for everybody. And again, don't say you understand them, demonstrate that you understand. If we have kids misbehaving, we can't fix that behavior until we understand why they're misbehaving. Now, I am going to go through a couple of other things real quick. Some of the tactics that you have to compete with, by the way. The exaggerated shock. Have you ever given somebody an offer or a counteroffer and they make that face? I can't believe you're offering that. So that is always a tactic when they make that face. Turn it into humor. I'm sorry, are you having a stroke? Do you need medication? There's something wrong with your face. Always try and use a little humor to get them to see that you're not gonna fall for something like that. Everything you do, you're trying to make sure they don't fall for it. Good cop, bad cop. Why do people use good cop, bad cop? Because it works. It absolutely works. So some of the countermeasures are, hey, I'm not a novice. Let's dispense with the good cop, bad cop routine and determine what actually works. Good cop, bad cop works because it sounds like somebody's on your side when neither one of them is, okay? That's why it works. Let's split the difference. Always say no. No, I don't think so, but I'll come back with a counter that's less than splitting the difference. By the way, you'll almost always do better that way. The clock is ticking. I don't understand who created this deadline. Intimidation and threats. If that happens, take a break. I'm done. I'm walking away. We can renegotiate when you're calm. Tell the other party you're not going to accept insults, belittlement, or aggressive behavior. The other one is change of players, where somebody's negotiating with you and then suddenly they change the person. That's all right. I'll wait till the other person comes back and is available again. Escalation. The parties verbally agree on price when finalizing the transaction. The seller decides to raise their price. Have we all experienced that? All right. Then you have to take a step back and say, listen, John, would you really go back on your word? That, you have to take that honest approach. Would you really go back on your word? Is that something you're willing to do? And if they are, then back away from the transaction. Have you heard of the nibble? We've all experienced this, by the way. You get an agreement together, and then you're signing the agreement, and they say, well, I also want this. Just a little thing here, and I also want that. And then when you agree to that, they want something else. You've got to cut it off as early as possible and make sure that all issues are outlined in the beginning and keep saying that over and over again. But when you do have a deal fall apart, make sure the other party feels respected, even if the deal can't work out, because you're probably going to see them again at some point. Many of us leave here and we've got difficulty transferring new knowledge from a classroom into a conference room. Negotiation researchers have found. This is from one of Harvard's papers. The gains made during training can be quickly lost when we fall back into our old habits. So some of the things we want to do is be ready to make mistakes, regularly practice skills, and anticipate questions you don't want to answer before negotiation. Again, you know what questions they're going to ask that you don't want them to ask, that make you cringe, but be ready to answer those questions. I want you to practice smiling. People are going to smile back. Smile to the people out here, smile to the Uber driver, but smile at random people. You'll see them smile back. Practice labeling people's emotions and remaining silent. Verbal observations. Are you uncomfortable? Is something wrong? Label their emotions. Practice paraphrasing. When someone says something, listen to them and repeat it back in your own words. Did I understand you correctly? You mean this. Practice paraphrasing. Now, by the way, psychologically, it takes 64 to 67 times of you to repeat something for it to create a neural pathway. If you're going to use paraphrasing, if you're going to use parroting back certain language, if you're going to use negative questions, you've got to do it 64 to 67 times before it becomes ingrained. Now, most of us have been on 150, 3,000 listing appointments, whatever it is, and we know what we're going to say every step of the way, but we don't necessarily own a negotiation. Practice, drill, and rehearse, and write down what you've actually learned and what you have to work on yet. But if you're going to be doing something, keep doing it repetitively because it will eventually form that neural pathway that you're going to use.